Welcome again. Right now we're at Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 14. Dead to sin, free from sin, now living holy like him. Let's see what Paul says. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Don't forget, we just came from the previous passage where Paul just went into, you know, really expounding upon sin and grace and so on and so forth. And it seemed like just like a lull, you know, in the storm, a calm in the midst of the storm, so to speak. And here Paul starts to get into it. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? May it never be. My question is this. There are a lot of Christians that believe that the law is done away with. There is no law anymore. Now, Paul made it pretty clear that if there's no law, then there's no way that anybody could sin against a law that doesn't exist. If the law doesn't exist, if it's not in effect, then neither is there sin. So what would Paul mean by let's not sin? Well, because the law is in effect. Why is the law in effect? Because it is the Word of God. It is the Word of God. Nowhere did God ever say in the Scriptures that it is temporary. It is the Word of God forever settled in heaven. And he said over and over and over and over again, some 20, 30, 40 some odd times, just in the Torah alone, this is forever. This is eternal. This is perpetual. This ordinance is to all generations, forever. This law is the law of God. We who died to sin, died to sin. That doesn't sound like a lot of Christians today, does it? I mean, we hear so many Christians today say, I'm struggling with this, I'm struggling with that. You know, I fall into sin all the time. Paul said he died to sin. He died to sin. Dead men don't sin. We who died to sin, how can we live in it any longer? Wonderful, wonderful question. You know, I just love this question. We who died to sin, how can we live in it any longer? And I know a lot of you might say, how do you die to sin? How is it that Paul said he died to sin? How can that be? How can somebody actually die to sin? It's what Paul's been saying all along here. It's by faith. It's by faith. When Jesus died, when you look up by faith and you see him hanging on the cross, and he died, you are to say with Paul, I have been crucified with Christ. Jesus is not just your substitute. In fact, the idea of him being a substitute is kind of deceptive because it's like, well, he died, so I don't have to die. No. Not a substitute. Jesus is your identity. You are to look upon him and you are to identify with him. When he died on that cross, you are to say, I have been crucified with Christ. I am crucified with Christ. Dead to sin. Dead to this world. Dead to the lusts and the pride of life. Dead. We who died to sin, how can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all we who were baptized again, meaning immersion, immersed, baptized, baptism being a symbol or a type of death, baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death. So when you are baptized in Christ, when you are baptized in Jesus' name, it does not mean that you are dipped in water and someone recites in Jesus' name over you. It doesn't matter how many people might say in Jesus' name. And for those of you who are honest with yourself, you know there are a lot of you who prayed in Jesus' name for a lot of things and it didn't happen, okay? I mean, in Jesus' name means a whole lot more than just saying it with your lips, just speaking the words, just going through the motions of just speaking the word. It's a whole lot more than that, okay? When you are baptized in Jesus' name, when you are baptized in Christ Jesus, it means you're baptized into his death. It means that you are dead to sin. Dead, I say, dead to sin. We were buried, therefore, with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we also might walk in newness of life. Now, this is not talking about baptism in water. It's talking about baptism in the death of Jesus. Most people who get baptized in water are not truly even baptized in Jesus. They're not truly baptized into his death the way they're supposed to be. That's what it's all supposed to be about. I mean, how many times have you seen people, they get baptized, they're supposed to die with Jesus, and then they get raised out of the water in newness of life, and they go and they have a smoke afterwards, or they go and they cuss and swear and do all kinds of sinful things. That is not baptism in Jesus' name. That is not baptism in truth. That's just going through some kind of motions that happens on the outside and not on the inside. That's like what Paul wrote earlier, saying basically you can go through the motions of obeying certain parts of the law, but you don't have that law, that Torah, in your heart. You don't have it in your heart, because you can go through the motions and still not have it in your heart. And you know, the true Torah of God, the true Torah is a Torah of the heart. You know, that's what Jesus was talking about. Even though you don't do the motion, if you do it in your heart, you're still violating that Torah. So the true Torah of God, it goes deep in the heart. And yes, it includes all of the obedience, all of the motions. Certainly does. But the motions without the heart is kind of fruitless. It's almost like a marriage. Somebody can say, oh, I'm married to you in my heart, but never actually go through the steps of being really married. Okay? Someone can just say, I just feel like I'm married to you in my heart. Well, in your heart, you can be married to somebody, but you should. I mean, really, really do the ceremony. In the same way, you can love God with all your heart and you can repent in your heart, but you got to obey. You've got to really do what the law tells you to do. Verse 4 again, we were buried therefore with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we also might walk in newness of life. When Jesus rose from the dead, that was being born again. When Jesus rose from the dead, and by faith we can connect with that, and we can say we have died to sin through his death. We were buried with him, and we rose with him in newness of life. We're not the same person. Israel and Jacob is not the same person. Abraham and Abram is not the same person. Paul and Shaul, not the same person. For if we become united with him in the likeness of his death, we will also be part of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him. Doesn't that sound familiar? Again, Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Our old man, speaking of the sinful, selfish person you were, the old man, was crucified with him. Not, well, I'm trying. Not, well, you know what, I'm doing my best. No, was done. That the body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be in bondage to sin. You hear some people say, well, I don't want to be in bondage. No, we're not in bondage. You know, don't give me this Torah stuff, because the law of God just brings us into bondage. Well, listen, if you're not in bondage to Torah, you're in bondage to sin. This here is binary. It's either it's on or it's off. It's either it's yes or it's no. If you are not in bondage to the law of God, you are in bondage to sin. And may I say, you need to be free. For he who has died has been freed from sin. But if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dies no more. This is what the writer of Hebrews meant in Hebrews chapter 6, when it's like, well, if you have come to the knowledge of the truth, you've tasted the heavenly gift, and you've fallen away, it's impossible to come back. That's an impossible situation, because if you're dead, you're dead. Okay? If you're not dead, you're not dead. If you're dead, you're dead. You're free. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin. To sin one time. But the life that he lives to God. Thus, consider yourselves also here to be dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore, don't let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lusts. Listen, you know, there are some people who say, well, you know what, we're not supposed to obey the law of God anymore. You know, if we have to obey the law of God, why did Jesus die for us? Jesus died for you so that you could be empowered to obey God's law, not to be lawless antinomians that Jesus rejects on the last day, like he said he would in Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. Many will come to him. Many, he said, saying, you know, we've cast out demons in your name. We've done many mighty miracles. We've prophesied. Oh, we even prophesied. We're prophets of Jesus, of God. And he will turn to them and he will say, I never knew you, you worker of iniquity, you worker of lawlessness, anomia in the Greek, a negative, nomia, law or Torah, no Torah. You don't have Torah in your life. You are not going by Torah. You're going by faith. Jesus did not deny that they were working miracles, that they were prophesying, that they were casting out demons, but Jesus did deny them entry into heaven. So if you're not obeying the Torah, you're obeying sin. That's what it says here. That's what it says in the scriptures, that you should not obey it, that being sin, in its lusts. Do you obey sin or do you obey God? You can't drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils too. Also, do not present your members here meaning the parts of your body, to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as alive from the dead, and your members, your body, your physical body, as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin will not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. Okay, what an awesome statement here, because a lot of people don't know what it means by saying you're not under the law. Paul made it perfectly clear. You are either obeying sin or you're obeying God, and you can't obey God if there's no law to obey. If there's no commandments, if there's no instructions of God, you can't obey it. Now, there are different interpretations of this. There are people who say, well, Paul is talking about the law of sin. You're not under the law of sin, okay? You can look at it that way. Other people might say, well, you know what? The term under the law is a figure of speech. Just like how we say, you know, if someone is sick today, we say they're under the weather. You know, one time I had a meeting and I asked the people who were present at the meeting, how many of you are under the weather today? And nobody raised their hands. I said, well, does that mean that you're all in space right now, that you're all outside of the atmosphere of the earth, that you're somehow just floating around in space or, you know, on another planet or something like that, that you're not under the weather? I said, no, y'all know what it means, that you're sick. You're not experiencing negative effects from the weather. In the same way, if you're not under the law, it means you're not experiencing the negative effects from Torah. Why? Because you're obeying it. You're not obeying sin, you're obeying Torah. You're not obeying unrighteousness, you're obeying God, righteousness. And you see, true grace is power from God. True grace is not just God playing the blind guy saying, I don't see any of your sin. Hey, read Revelations chapter 2 and 3. God sees the sin of his church, and wow, do they ever get punished for it. I mean, and some of them get the boot, okay? I mean, God sees sin. So grace is the gift of God to empower you to overcome sin. Read Psalm 119. It is by grace. It's because God loved his people so much, he wanted to give them a gift. So when they got free from the bondage of Egypt, he gave them the law of liberty, the Torah. The Torah is the law of liberty. God is not like, well, you guys, I just went through all this trouble to put all these plagues on Egypt and to bring you guys through the Red Sea with mighty power and an outstretched arm and all these great and mighty works that I did for my people just to free them, just so that I could turn around and slap them with another bondage. The law. That's not the way God is. The Torah is the law of liberty. Liberty from bondage, liberty from sin. Don't miss the next session. Freedom and slavery. Until then, seek God with all your heart. And if you seek Him with all your heart, you will find Him. Call upon Him and He will show you great and mighty things. Love you guys.